Welcome to GCC Survey of Health Careers. I'm Lou Pugh, and today I'm here with Dr. Sun, who is an assistant professor of pharmacy practice at the College of Pharmacy in Western New England University. Yeah. So thank you for being here today.
Thanks for inviting me.
Would you like to start by talking a little bit about the pharmacy program at Western New England?
Oh yeah, I think the pharmacy program at Western New England is a new program. We have the first 75 students started last September, and so it's right now we're recruiting for the second year students will be coming in this September. So the program is going really well.
Mm-hmm. And what is your role in the faculty? What do you teach?
Okay, my area of specialty is in emergency medicine. So in 2 days a week, I'll be over the college, engaged in teaching with the didactic courses, facilitating the pharmacy labs. And on average, another 2 to 3 days, I'll be over my practice site, and which I provide direct patient care. It's happened to be my practice site is in Baystate Franklin Medical Center, which is right here in Greenfield.
Mm-hmm. So I know that we're all familiar with a pharmacist in the pharmacy, but what's the role of a pharmacist in the hospital in terms of, you're saying, direct patient care?
Right.
Yes.
What I mean, the direct patient care, probably majority of you will see pharmacists who are working in the drugstore,
mm-hmm.
and then you probably only see the dispensing part of the pharmacist job. And what is exciting about pharmacy career, and it is developing very fast also, is the expanding pharmacist role in patients' care. This is especially true if you work in a hospital setting, which is you're not only providing the right medication to the right patient, but you're also involving in pharmacotherapy treatment options for the patient. You're part of the team, part mm-hmm. of the decision process. For instance, pharmacists who are working in the hospital will go round with physicians and nurses every day. This is what we do at Baystate Franklin Medical Center. And it is true, actually, pretty much in every hospital. Pharmacists will go on the patient round with physicians and nurses, discuss the treatment options for the patient, make recommendations on the drug therapy changes, and provide monitoring on the side effects of the medications.
What kinds of coursework do students need to take in order to be successful in the pharmacy program, but also what are they required to take, say, as prerequisites before they're accepted?
Okay, basically, right now, the whole pharmacy education, if you start right after high school, is 6 years program,
mm-hmm.
2 year of pre-pharmacy program, which you will complete a lot of prerequisites, and then you go on for 4 more years of professional studies. So the total program is 6 years long.
Mm-hmm.
And then to prepare you, bless you, to get into the program, like I said, you have to finish the prerequisites. Mm-hmm. It's different for each school, but usually they are the basic sciences.
Mm-hmm.
You need to complete general biology 1 and 2 with labs, and general chemistry with labs, and finish organic chemistry, and some requirements on microbiology and anatomy. So that's basic sciences. And you also need to complete some of the natural sciences or this non-science part, for example, public speaking,
mm-hmm.
microeconomics, and ethics class. And so basically each school has different requirements in
mm-hmm.
terms of the courses you need to take. My recommendation is if you have a school, particular school in mind, you need to go on their website, check on the prerequisite courses.
Mm-hmm.
So pretty much it's 2 year pre-pharmacy school study plus 4 year pharmacy study.
Mm-hmm. So it sounds pretty rigorous, similar to medical school or nursing.
Yeah, it is a, actually a very rigorous program.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And can you share a bit about your own background as a pharmacist? What drew you to the teaching aspect? What kinds of experiences have you had in your career?
Oh, okay, yeah. So I, before I take the teaching job at Western New England last July, I was actually a clinical pharmacist working in the emergency department at Hospital of St. Raphael in New Haven, Connecticut. So where I work with, the unique thing about my previous role is I'm actually stationed in the ER for 8 hours a day and to work with physicians and nurses directly. We kind of discuss patient medical problem, why they are coming to the ER, and what treatment options there are for us to use to treat the patients. So I provide drug consultation and provide education to other healthcare providers. So that's my previous role. What draw on my, what I become a pharm, how I become a pharmacist, I was actually by training a chemist, mm-hmm. believe it or not. Mm-hmm. So I work in Pfizer pharmaceutical company mm-hmm. for about 7 or 8 years. Mm-hmm. You know, while I was working, so I, you know, I, because I, at that time my main job is to making compounds or mm-hmm. discover medications. Mm-hmm. So it's always in my mind, you know, what the medication will do to the patients. Mm-hmm. So I said maybe I can study pharmacy because as a pharmacist, we are the drug information expert, mm-hmm. supposed to be. Mm-hmm. And then, so my curiosity led me into pharmacy education.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I finished pharmacy school, so.
And are you involved in research in your role at Baystate Franklin Medical Center?
Oh yeah, actually, my responsibilities is, you know, we have, I kind of have different responsibilities. One is patient mm-hmm. care, another one is, like you mentioned, research.
Mm-hmm.
I, for instance, right now am working on a couple research projects. One is involving the medication safety to pediatric patients.
Mm-hmm.
And finding the best ways or the best practices that we can do at the hospital to reduce the medication errors for pediatric patients.
Mm-hmm.
And also engaging a couple other quality improvement projects in the ED.
Mm-hmm.
So to create a better patient care and a better medication safety environment for mm-hmm. the ED patients.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, and I involve a lot of the research.
Mm-hmm. And are you including other hospitals outside of the Baystate system in that study, or are you focusing on Baystate?
So right now, what I'm basically focusing on the Franklin Medical Center.
Okay.
But
mm-hmm.
keep in mind, Franklin is part of Baystate mm-hmm. Health, and mm-hmm. we have the major hospital in Springfield. And on a daily basis, we work very closely with the main hospital
mm-hmm.
because any protocol we develop over there, we want to share with them.
Mm-hmm.
Or if they have any research that can help us, you know, we'll like to know. So
mm-hmm.
yes, we work closely with mm-hmm. other hospitals.
Mm-hmm. So what's the favorite aspect of your work, or if there's more than one, what are your favorite parts of your job?
I think the favorite part is it changes every day.
Mm-hmm.
That's the fun part.
Mm-hmm.
Especially for me, from my background, I am in emergency care.
Mm-hmm.
If you work in emergency department, you never know what will happen
mm-hmm.
for the next hour, for the next 2 hours.
Mm-hmm.
And also the fun part is I work directly with pharmacy students as a faculty. So I love teaching, you know, I love share knowledge with them, and also like them to ask me questions, challenge me,
mm-hmm.
so it's, so it's, it is exciting.
Mm-hmm. And your role is a little bit different because you're teaching in addition to working as a pharmacist in the ED. What would a typical day look like for, say, a hospital pharmacist who's not teaching?
Okay.
Yeah.
I think the typical day, if you're not involved in teaching at the hospital, is you're processing medication orders. So what happens in the hospital is the physicians will see the patient, assess the patient, and then write medication orders. Before the nurses can give the medications, have to have another check to make sure the medications the physician prescribe are appropriate. For instance, the dose is not too high or not too low, and there's no drug-drug interactions if patient taking multiple medications and no drug allergies. So the pharmacist has to review all the medication orders. So part of that's the main job the hospital pharmacists do, just to make sure the medication orders are correct. And also, they are there to serve as the drug information specialist. For instance, if physicians have questions on which medications that they should prescribe to the patient, what are the appropriate doses, they will call the pharmacist, and the pharmacist will provide the answers or do research, get back to them. And if you are nurses, if you want to administer medication, if you don't know how should I administer the medication, for instance, if you have an IV medication, and then what's the rate that I can infuse the medication to the patient, oftentimes nurses will call the pharmacist, mm-hmm. and the pharmacist will provide the answers to them.
Mm-hmm. So what are some of the challenges you see for new pharmacists or pharmacists in general?
I think that part is better be answered by dividing where your practice siting is.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, majority of the pharmacy graduates, or half of them, will go to a community drugstore like CVS, Walgreens, Rite Aid.
Mm-hmm.
And the challenging part of that, probably you can imagine, it is usually is a busy environment,
mm-hmm.
a lot of medications the pharmacists have to verify. And if there are unclear medications, the pharmacist will have to contact the physician to make changes. And so it somewhat require you, I would say, a little bit stressful environment.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have to deal with. I think the nice part working in that area is you get a better pay, and also, your hours are sometimes somewhat fixed,
mm-hmm.
unlike if you work in hospital, you probably have to take some evening shifts or
mm-hmm.
work some weekends.
Mm-hmm.
In retail setting, is the hours probably a little bit better.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you work in hospital setting, you have to be familiar with all the hospital policies, procedures in terms of medication administration, and always keep up to date to your clinical knowledge. For instance, oftentimes physicians and nurses will ask you about some new medications, how they use, and if you don't keep up with your knowledge, you
mm-hmm.
have no idea.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the challenging part in hospital setting. And then the challenging part of working in academia, if you want to be a faculty in the College of Pharmacy, then you have to keep up with your teaching and research, because we are expected to have publications
mm-hmm.
in academia. So
mm-hmm. yes. Now I'm wondering, in terms of, well, let's say in your role at Franklin,
mm-hmm.
do you have pharmacy technicians that you oversee? Do you have pharmacy techs that work there in the hospital, or no?
Yeah, usually mm-hmm. Every hospital, they have pharmacists and pharmacy technicians,
mm-hmm.
and pharmacy technicians are great help to pharmacists.
Mm-hmm.
Just purely from my role, I do not work directly, or I do not supervise the pharmacy technicians, because my role is more on the educator part.
Mm. Right.
But keep in mind, I do work in the emergency departments. I need to know how the medications will be delivered and when can we expect the medications. Oftentimes the technicians will help me.
And can you talk a little bit about the role of pharmaceutical companies in drug research and some of the impacts that that may have on pharmacists, if any?
Okay, in terms of research on?
In terms of research, the fact that pharmaceutical companies are often paying for research,
right,
and then promoting the use of that drug, I'm wondering, in terms of your own research, is it supported through pharmaceutical companies? Is it through foundations? Is it a combination of those kinds of things?
I think probably a combination, because a lot of times, for instance, if the drug manufacturer wants to develop new medications, they need to conduct clinical trials. Mm-hmm. A lot of clinical trials can be done in a hospital setting. Mm-hmm. So some larger hospitals will have research pharmacists, will be involving in drug research clinical trials. And also, sometimes you can, a lot of time we work also with the medical information department at the manufacturer, drug company. For instance, if we want to get detailed about some information about the medication, we can contact the medical department. But one thing, we can work closely with the manufacturer, but on the other hand, we don't want to have them influence our clinical judgment. Because a lot of the time, the representative from the drug company will come to the drugstore or go to the hospital promoting their medications. So as a pharmacist, you have to exercise your clinical judgment not to be influenced by what they say about the medication.
I'm wondering if there are questions in the audience.
So when a new medicine comes out, like for clinical trial, do they let you know, like, do they send them to hospitals to try out, or do they just, like, you know, how do you know, like, for clinical trials?
So the question is about the clinical trials in the hospital. So usually this will be done in a larger hospital, and then which have research pharmacists. And then what it does is the drug manufacturer will provide study protocols. How do they want the medications to be trialed in the patient? What are the monitoring parameters? How they should respond if there are side effects occurring in the patients? So they will provide protocols, and then the pharmacist, research pharmacist or pharmacy department will help facilitate the study.
And then, like, a person would have to sign, like, a paper, and, like, it's all this criteria?
Oh, yeah, the patients, they have to provide consent form to the patients, which, and clearly explaining the benefits and possible side effects if you do want to take, to be part of the study. You have to get the consent form clearly explained to the patients.
And they have clinical trials pretty much, like, for every medicine? Anything?
Yeah, I would say every new medication, if you want to bring to the market in this country, has to be go through at least three phases of clinical trials. So yes, you have to do that.
What are the three phases?
Usually, you know, you need to do some studies, start with animal studies to demonstrate the safety and the efficacy. And then you move on to healthy patients, and then you go to the patients has medical problems. So there's, like, if you're interested, you can go to the FDA website, you know, searching clinical trials. And also after drug get approved, and it's not done yet for the manufacturer, because they have to keep monitoring the side effects.
Later.
Right. Probably you heard, you know, sometimes the drug get removed from market because when you apply the new medication to a larger population, you may see some side effects you never see in your smaller studies. So, yeah, it's a good question. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Other questions?
How about the drugs from Canada? What do they affect? How do they affect the American industry?
I think basically your question is about drug import from other countries. I think the main problem is you have to be make sure the medications you get, no matter where you get, even you know from this country, is the correct medication, uncontaminated. Sometimes you probably heard the drug get recalled from the market, not because of the drug itself has bad effects, only because there are some manufacturing problem. For example, get contaminated, and then the manufacturer need to remove certain lots of the medications. And if you're talking about importing from medications from other countries, you have to make sure they are properly licensed by the FDA, their manufacturing conditions is up to the standard, and the medication storage appropriate. So a lot of things you have to be considerate of. So
thank you.
You're welcome.
Other questions?
So you spoke of doing research involving medication safety in pediatric patients.
Mm-hmm.
So are you creating the like standard operating procedures for like passing that to them?
Oh yeah, basically you. So what I did is I started off, you know, did an analysis for the past 5 or 10 years, the medication errors in the hospital, and then we move on to research on the best practices, what are the national standards recommend us to do. And then we, based on our findings, based on the national standards, and we propose the new guidelines or procedures or protocols that can help reduce the medication errors.
For the schooling, so how many credits? Is it you said in 2 years to the for the
pre-pharmacy,
and
yeah.
Then you got 4 years.
Yeah, the 4 years is actually 3 years of classroom studies, which you will take a lot of courses plus laboratory work. And then the last year is the clinical rotations, which you will go to drugstore or to the hospital or to you know long-term care facilities, and then to learn the practical part.
So what it is?
There will be a lot of credits, yes.
So are you licensed or certified or? Like, what is your main title?
Oh, yeah, after, what happens after you finish pharmacy school and then you get your diploma, then you sit in the National Pharmacist Licensing Exam. And once you pass that, then depends on where you want to practice. You need to take the law exam, law licensing exam in each state. And then you can get license once you pass all the exams. For instance, if you want to get license in Massachusetts, you first need to get a pharmacist license, and then you pass the pharmacy law exam in this state. After that, you become a licensed pharmacist in the state of Massachusetts.
Okay, so like law,
yeah,
like criminal justice, all that kind of stuff, or is it different?
No, it's basically anything related to pharmacy practice. So what are the regulations? So
once you get that first license, you can go and get the second license for any state that you want to work in, like Massachusetts.
Yeah, you can do that.
Like Canada or whatever, as long as you got that first one.
Oh, yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, yeah. Once you get your original license, then you can apply to transfer to another state. For example, I was originally licensed in Connecticut, state of Connecticut.
Oh, okay.
Then because I take this job, then my practice site in Massachusetts, so I have to apply Massachusetts license, which is easier. You just take Massachusetts law, and then you can do the transfer.
What is your title?
My title, I should be licensed pharmacist. Right. If you want to add more titles, then
you can add whatever you want. We
I know.
And you're also a doctor because it's a doctorate program.
Yeah, it's a doctorate program.
Yes.
So are you an MD or
MD? Oh, PharmD.
Doctor of pharmacy.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you had to have, because it was like 6 years, like that's a long time. Mm-hmm. There's got to be like some kind of doctorate in there for 6 years.
Yes.
Now a technician only has to do the 2 years?
I think technician, each state has a little bit different, mm-hmm. you know, requirements. Mm-hmm. I think the nice thing, if you work in college, the student will address you doctor. So.
Mm-hmm.
And I think also the exciting part about pharmacy is there's a lot of career options after you get your doctor of pharmacy degree. You can work in retail store, you can work in hospital, you can work in university, you can go nursing home, federal government, for instance, you know, FDA, and then you can start your own business if you can compete with CVS. You know, so. Mm-hmm. And then, mm-hmm. so a lot of career options, and then also the pay is also pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
it's rare for, you know, have in the middle of 20, you know, 20 something graduates making well over $100,000 a year,
mm-hmm.
so
mm-hmm.
which is a yep. nice career to
yes.
consider. So,
yes.
if we want to throw the money part,
so. It's a lot yeah. of sciences, though, right? A lot of sciences.
Oh yeah, definitely. That's for sure.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
If you're into science.
Yeah, but I mean, if you have the determination,
yep.
everybody can do it. Because, you know, my instance, you know, I'm a chemist in training, but I always have the fear about biology, anatomy,
yeah.
you know, this and that, which it turned out, you know, I do it. I did it. So I think the key point is you have to have the determination, you put a lot of effort, then you'll be successful. So, yeah.
Do you still have your Connecticut license as well as the Mass?
Oh, yeah. I actually still keep Connecticut license, so.
Once you're licensed, how long is your license good for? Do you have to renew?
Oh yeah, it's, I think almost you renew every 1 year or every 2 years, but it's a relatively easy process now. You only need to continue roughly around 15, they call it continuing education credits, which you can get it by attending some continuing education lectures, by doing some home study, and go to the internet. The key point is just to keep your knowledge up to date, because
mm-hmm.
I was sitting there listening to the previous speaker,
mm-hmm.
is no matter which health career you go, it's a lifelong learning. So they force you to do that if you don't want to do that.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Yeah.
Any other questions? Well, I thank you very much, Dr. Sun.
Thank you.
This
nice
is great.
Here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.